what up, y'all? Let the room fill up a little bit. Let the room fill up. Shout out to everybody, man. Happy Friday to everybody, man. Make sure you have a safe weekend. Very important to have a safe weekend, man. Real talk, man. Fastball right here. Split finger fastball. It's the curveball. That's the changeup. And then the knuckleball. Let's go, baby. What's up, everybody? Happy Friday. Welcome to the Al York Sports Show. Open sessions, another Friday, another show. And like I said, I thank all of y'all for tuning in, because y'all could be doing anything else than tuning in to my show. And that's why you're going to get everything I got every Friday, everything I got. And before I start this show, shout out and happy birthday to the champion, Dwayne Beeman, a.k.a. Mr. Stop Running. Beeman, you know I got you, baby. You my dog, boy. You my dog. My man said Louis Tion. I like that, baby. But shout out to Dwayne Beeman. Shout out to my little cousin Mike Johnson from the 959 floor. Happy birthday to you. Big Hump, I see you. Steve Levine, y'all better tune in. I got a great show lined up for y'all. And like every week, y'all already know what it is with the Al York Sports Show. Shout out to the East Coast, West Coast, Midwest, Las Vegas, New York City, LES to the death. Triple H Entertainment, Syndicate Radio, TV, D. Beeman, happy birthday, One Voice, to my beloveds, the Dog Catcher, the Secret Weapon, the Specialist, and Credit Fix, never too late to get your credit. IG me, inbox me, email me, al.newyork@yahoo.com, Credit Fix. Another fucking Friday, I can't wait. We got 3 to 4 callers, it's going to be popping today. Let me see what I can start off with. Let me go right into the MLB sad news I found out today. Eric Kay, a former director and communications of the Los Angeles Angels, has been charged by the Drug Enforcement Agency with illegally supplying drugs to pitcher Tyler Skaggs. That's the pitcher from the Angels that died in a hotel room. Eric Kay was supplying the pitcher drugs. So basically, he was a drug dealer in a fancy way in the upper class. An upper class drug dealer is what Eric Kay was, and he's going to get life in prison for this because he killed, I think, 27 years old Tyler Skaggs. I forgot exactly what age it is. He was feeding them drugs, and he ended up dying in the Texas hotel. Sad news, man. In other news, the Atlanta Braves are more than happy to welcome Nick Markakis back, who decided to sit out during the coronavirus pandemic. He said family first, but then he's watching the Braves play on TV, and he said that it was killing him. It was killing him to watch and not be able to help his team. And Markakis, who's pushing 36, 37 years old, he probably figured out he ain't got too many years left. So you know what? Let me get back to it. And he came back with a bang, hit a game-winning home run yesterday against the Blue Jays. Salute to Nick Markakis and the Atlanta Braves. I like this that he came back. That showed the team a lot. In other news, Mets, Yoenis Cespedes this Sunday. It's ironic how a guy just opts out of his contract, basically during the season, don't let nobody know, left his hotel in Atlanta. His agent didn't even know where he was. So this comes and tells me a guy to do something this vicious was tremendously unhappy. Don't like the way the team is running. Don't like the way the team is playing. They got killed, I think, the two prior games before that, giving up a huge lead on top of that. So Yoenis was like, fuck it. I'm out of here. Now, do I agree with him? No, that was a horrible move. You don't win no points doing that. With teams or the MLB, by him doing this, He's going to hurt himself now to get on another MLB team because he basically quit it on his team. And you don't do that as a baseball player. And that's exactly what Cespedes did. So good luck, Cespedes, getting back in the league. Good luck. Hold up. I got a couple things here. Okay, hold up, guys. We got our first caller. Yeah, what's up? Welcome to the Al York Sports Show. What's going on? Hello? You can hear me?
Yeah, what's happening, man? What's going on?
Oh, this our pick guy, the dog catcher. You got you got 4 minutes for us. Give out the free picks. But before we get into that, you know I keep it real on my show. You got start, which I'm not worrying about. I know what you're about. You're 3-5, but the thing is, people are going to think that you down units, and you're not down because you gave out two huge dogs, which kind of cancel out the, you know, the 3-5 record, but you had even money, but you got a losing record. So let me just put that out there because I know how you're going to steamboat back. Tell us what you like today. You got 3 minutes to do it. Talk to us.
And just to reiterate, anything I say I like, I back up with my own money. I like Seattle Mariners today. I think they're going to beat I like the Mariners to beat the Rockies today at 6:40.
Okay, the Mariners tonight is the free pick. Give us a line and give us the pitching matchups, if you don't mind.
Atlanta, $1.20. Mariners are -120. They're the small favorite.
Okay.
The pitching matchup, I don't know how to pronounce those pitchers, Santanez or something.
Right.
For the Rockies. And then I like the Seattle. His name starts with a K. I don't know what the hell his name is.
It's probably that either the Chinese or the Japanese pitcher, I think.
Yeah, that guy.
My boy said a Seattle line moved a lot. That's a good play. You heard that from my boy Labriciano. So he also with you on this play. So we're giving out the Seattle Mariners at -120 against the Colorado Rockies. And they're at home, dog catcher?
Yeah, they're home favorite.
Okay, so they're playing at home. The Mariners are playing at home. So what else you might have? Do you got anything lined up for tomorrow? Because we got 2 minutes left. Before my next call,
I haven't looked at tomorrow. I do got something in 2 minutes, and I'm sure nobody can get it in. But if you can catch a live one, if you see the Diamondbacks down by one, catch a live bet. They're going to beat the Padres today. I like the Padres to lose to the Diamondbacks.
Okay, so the game started already is what he's saying. You can get the Arizona Diamondbacks on a live play. They down one run. So you probably could take
that. No, they're not down nothing. Oh,
it's tie game?
Nothing. Yeah, it's about to start.
It's about to start. You know what? I reiterate. Just get that game in if you could get it in. If you got access to do it. He likes the D-backs today to beat the Padres. But definitely Seattle's the play. So you want us to count this as a play or this is just a throw-in?
No, that's a play.
Okay, so we got two plays. You got Arizona, if you could get that in for all the live watchers right now. And Seattle starts at 6:40, 9:40 Eastern. So y'all got plenty of time to get that game in. And right now, if you got any access in front of you, you can get into Arizona Diamondbacks. At what line?
You get the Diamondbacks +10.
Okay, so you can actually get the D-backs for plus money. So we got two plays, dog catcher. Seattle -120 for two units, and the D-backs +110 for two units. Copy?
Yep.
Okay, then. So anything else you'd like to say before we hang up, brother?
No, carry on, partner. Carry on. I'll talk to you in a minute.
Okay, we're going to holler. Let's go 2-0. Let's turn this wheel around. Let's show the people what the dog catcher's about. Copy?
You know that.
Okay, guys. So appreciate your night and enjoy the games. Dog catcher, enjoy the games. Okay, guys, y'all heard it. Those are the first two plays. I got a caller calling in at 6:10. I really don't want to jump into another topic immediately because it's definitely going to get interrupted. And if he doesn't call in the next 2 minutes, I got a backup guy that's going to call. So I'm prepared for that. But like I said, guys, we're going to give y'all free plays early in the show for that night. Because, you know, Friday games usually start about 7 Pacific, 10 Eastern. So my show starts at 6. So you got more than enough time to get that play at them 7 o'clock games. Or we'll push you a game on Saturday where you got way more than enough time. So we're giving out free plays on the show. We're not starting out too good, but trust me, those who've been following me know we always turn it around. That's what we do on my show. So I'm waiting a couple more minutes for this caller. Anybody got any questions, throw them up. Yeah, because I'm not going to start something and not be able to finish. Peace the Bottle, I see you. Buck Flair. Lewis Lewis, I see you. Ronald Ortiz. Let me see who else up there. We got Slam Boogie. Yeah, I'm calling everybody out, man. You know how I do on my show. I'm going to give my man one more minute. If he doesn't call, I'm going to have somebody else call up in here. Lewis, I see you, baby. Be ready for your topic. Dog, I'm more than ready tonight, man. Any questions you guys got before my next caller, put them on the post. I'm already fucking excited, man. Dead ass. Big Dave, I see you, baby. This the shout-out moment. As I'm waiting for a phone call, this the shout-out moment right here. Salute to my baby, Holly Harrison. Continues to do her thing. God bless you. God bless you in the work you continue to put out for me, which I highly appreciate it. I want you to know that at all times. You been watching any NHL? Lubriciano, to be honest with you, I tuned in a little bit to the Vegas night game the other day. But no, I'm not tuning in strong. If that's what you asking me, no. If you want to call in on that and debate about the NHL, I'd be more than happy to have you come on and do your thing, brother. Still waiting on that call. Matter of fact, let me try to reach out to him because I know him. He's going to end up calling me while somebody else is calling me. Give me a minute, gentlemen. I don't care how unprofessional this looks. This is how I get down. I get right to it. What's up? What up, Venna? I see you, baby. I love you too, dog. You already know.
Big A.
Hey, yo, let me ask you something, dog. I love you to death. But why are you playing with my time schedule?
My bad, fam.
Yo, it's 6:13. I told you 6:10. Okay, so Tony Brown, a.k.a. the Black Shark, first time guy. On the show, this guy did videos with me, studio with me. Tony Brown's not no rookie. Tony Brown, anything you want to add on to yourself before we get it going? Because we got a big show today.
Yeah, my bad, man. I just want to say my bad for the three-minute time schedule. I was trying to get everything in order so I can have a big show, but I'm glad to be here. What's going on with you, Al?
Oh, man, we chilling, man. The people's just waiting on you. I'm waiting on you. You ready to get this shit popping?
Let's rock.
Okay, first thing first. NBA. I'm going to give you some teams and they wreck it real fast. And you tell me if they pretenders or contenders, meaning if they're going to get through the first round or lose the first round. Copy?
Let's do it. Let's do it.
Milwaukee Bucks, 55-14. Let me mention some players. You got the Greek Freak, Bledsoe, Middleton, Marvin Williams. Wesley Matthews, Kyle Kover, Brook Lopez. Talk to us.
I mean, on paper, that's the best team in the East. You know what I mean? Like, Giannis is the MVP last year. He's probably going to win it back-to-back this year. They got the most complete team. I think last year, they were just a victim of too much early success. You know what I mean? Like, they came out of nowhere, and the playoffs was new to them. So, they, you know, the playoffs is a whole different animal in the NBA, baby. So, they weren't able to complete the journey. But this time, man, they're my favorite to come out of the East for sure.
Okay, so they will come out the East, is what Tony Brown is saying today on the Al York Sports Show. Okay, my opinion.
Fully contenders.
Okay, I got to give them the edge that they will come out, but Boston's going to give them everything they can handle. You heard it right now. They might even beat them, but if I had a gun in my head, I'd say Milwaukee will prevail. Okay, Toronto Raptors, 49-18, led by Lowry, Kyle Lowry, Pascal Siakam, Van Fleet, Ibaka, Gasol, Anunoby. Your take real fast on the Raptors. Real fast.
Well, Well, I mean, to be honest with you, the Raptors was always good in the East. They just couldn't get past LeBron. As soon as LeBron leaves out of there, they win the championship. Now, they want to say it was because of Kawhi Leonard, but look at them now.
Right.
You know what I mean? They're still rocking and rolling, but I think that's probably who Milwaukee will face in the finals if they don't get seeded up in the early rounds, because that's the second best team in the East.
Okay, do they get through the first round?
Yeah, they for sure.
Okay, Toronto gets through. This is, to me, the greatest story in the NBA as far as this year. It's the fact that they lost the Claw, top three player in the NBA. They won right. with the Claw last year. Everybody knows that. Kawhi Leonard. I expected nothing from these guys. I'm going to keep it 100 with you. I didn't expect Toronto to make no noise. Probably make the playoffs as an eighth seed. You would have told me 49-18, I would have told you, fuck you. Straight up and down.
Yeah.
So they're the most overachieving team. Van Fleet stepping up. Lowry showing he's about it finally. And Pascal Siakam, one of the most underrated basketball players in the NBA. His name would start coming up top 10, top 5 before you know it. But I think they get through one round max and that's it. I think they already accomplished more than we all expected. Copy?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, they're overachieving. And like you said, the first round exit seems about right because Kawhi was what made them the championship team. But they've always been a playoff team.
Okay. Boston Celtics, Tatum, Jaylen Brown, Kemba Walker, Smart, Hayward, Feast. Do Boston Celtics get through the first round if they was to finish today third overall in the East?
Yeah, I mean, you know, like you said, there's only so many teams. These guys ain't first-round exit type teams. You know what I mean? They're going to play the lower seed, and of course they'll get through the first round. But
can they get through the second round? Let me make it a little more difficult for you. Can Boston get through round two?
No. This is the upset of the tournament. This is when everybody gets their dog money out.
Okay.
Boston's complete team on paper or whatever, but I don't think they can handle the defending champ Toronto. I don't think they can handle Milwaukee, and so this is where Boston will make their exit in the second round.
Well, I would have to say there was slight better with Kyrie Irving. Kyrie Irving is better than Kemba Walker, but I think Kemba Walker will make them a better team eventually, and plus with Marcus Smart, I think they will make them better, but I don't think they're going to win it all this year. I think if they do lose, they're going to take whoever they lose to the seventh game in the second round. I think they clear the first round, and they're going to go at least game seven in that second round. You heard it from me. I think they could beat Milwaukee, but they might come up short in the seventh game. Real quick, Miami Heat, Jimmy Buckets, Adebayo, Jay Crowder, Dragic, Hero, you know what I mean, and Nunn, and Iguodala. You can't forget Iggy. Real fast, Heat.
Right. Well, to be honest, I think they could get dumped in the first round, too. You talked about a team we thought was overachieving in Toronto, which they were. You know, you lose the MVP of your team and the MVP of the league, it's going to, you know, surprise some people if you win. But Miami's out of nowhere. Like, this Miami team is playing lights out, balls out.
No, but Jimmy Buckets brings that. You understand? He brings fire to those guys.
He brings a lot of individual talent and a lot of, like you said, he's more of a locker room, he's the heart and soul of the team. If Jimmy Buckets is going to put him on their back and beat Giannis, if Jimmy Buckets is going to put him on their back and beat Boston, no.
Okay. Last but not least, Indiana Pacers, led by Brogdon, T.J. Warren, Oladipo, Miles Turner, real fast. Fifth seed right now. Do they get out the first round? They'll probably play Miami.
Yeah, no, not at all. That's what I'm saying. Those are the lower tier teams that are talking about, the Boston, the Milwaukee's, and the Toronto's. Those are the teams that they can beat. You know what I mean? These are the East lower seeds. Good seasons, but at the end of the day, it's the East, and they're still a few pieces away. And
right.
those, you know, the top three seeds are going to go out the first round, and those last three seeds you mentioned, those will be the first round exit.
Right. I think this is going to be the most intriguing first round matchup. If it does end up Miami, Indiana, I think that's going to be the best first round series. And then second round, everything's going to be tightened up. You already know that. We go to the Western Conference real quick. We got 5 minutes, Tony Brown, so we might just stay on the NBA because I really want to hear your NBA talk.
Okay, for
LA
sure.
Lakers, King James, Unibrown, KCP, Danny Green, Kuzma, Swish, Morris, and Waiters. Real quick, your take on the Lakers. Of course, they're going to get by the first round, but do they continue to keep winning?
Yeah, that's the championship roster you just named right there, and I'm not just saying that because of a restart or anything. I said this when we picked up Anthony Davis.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, Anthony Davis and LeBron James, that's Magic and Kareem reincarnated. We're always going to have the two best players on the planet on the floor at the same time. It's going to be hard to beat that team four times, period, no matter who you are.
I agree. I gave out the Clippers at the beginning of the year. I said a couple weeks ago, Lakers look too strong. I think it's done. I think it's brought up for the Lakers to win it. LeBron ring chasing. Kobe Bryant, NBA guard, he's going to do whatever he can do to get the Lakers to win. And not only that, they got the deepest team. So when you put all those components together, I see the Lakers winning it. I could be wrong. My boy Dogcatcher totally disagrees. He likes the Rockets, and the Rockets did whoop on them the other day, or was it yesterday? I mean, Rockets is looking like, and I said it, that's my down low team, but I like the Lakers to win. Then I got the Clippers and the Rockets. But the Rockets is looking tough, but I'm not going to get to them yet. Lakers, I think, win it all. Let's go to the next one. L.A. Clippers,
all right.
The Claw, PG-13, Montrell, Reggie Jackson, Morris, Sweet Lou Williams, Shamet. Real fast, for we can finish in time.
Yeah, I mean, the Clippers are good. And like you said, getting down to the first round, that's too easy. Of course, the Clippers are going to make it out of the first round. But will they win it all? No way. Houston is the team that I like to compete for the Lakers. Houston reminds me of Toronto from last year. Houston was making it to the finals with consistency. They just couldn't get over the Golden State hump. Now Golden State's not even in the playoffs. Houston is the favorite to make it if they can get past the Lakers, which I don't think they can. But if they do, I mean, I like Houston and L.A. for sure. The Clippers. The Clippers have been the Clippers since Danny Manning. Let's just leave it at that.
Okay, we got 2 minutes. I'm going to skip Denver, OKC. And I hate to skip Utah because Utah is a real deadly team, you know, with Donovan Mitchell, Gobert, Ingles, Clarkson, Bogdanovic, and Conley. But I'm going to go right to Houston. We got about 2 minutes exactly. Rockets. I know you just spoke about them. I know you like them. You got to understand, they got no big man. Clint Capella was traded last year, but I like to pick up a Robert Covington out of Virginia. Covington is huge on that offense. He plays defense, but at the end of the day, you got no big man. How do you win without a big man? I understand you can play that Golden State pull up from threes, but in the playoffs, that's one shot and out. That's one shot and out.
I'm going to ask you this. Who's the defending champs right now? Toronto. Tell me their big man right now. Go.
No, Marc Gasol was their big man, but he wasn't dominant. But he was there.
That's what I'm saying.
And Siakam,
saying.
No,
you don't need a big man.
No, they had some long dudes though. Siakam with his arms stretched out is long. Ibaka and Gasol. What Houston got down low? Name me one potential big man. Covington plays like a guard. PJ Tucker's the only one that'll beef you up, and he's only 6'6".
Yeah, that's not their game. They're not trying to beat anybody up. They score the most points in the league. James Harden puts up the most points in the league. In the game. Back to the basket is old, man. That's that old school mentality. They literally went small. They didn't lose their big man. They got rid of their big man so they can play small ball and killing people.
Yeah, but I'm going to tell you the difference real quick. But I got 1 minute. You got a great point there, Tony Brown. Another thing I like about this Houston team, unlike the Phoenix team that Dan Antoni used to have, they really didn't have no guys that can actually, you know, go to the hole. They didn't really have no guys that could go to the hole. I mean, they had, you know, Nash could go through and kick it out. Harden could go to the hole, draw the foul. Westbrook could go to the hole, draw the foul. P.J. Tucker could go to the hole, and Covington. So that's the difference. They don't have a big man, but they can't go to the hole. They can't go to the hole, and that would mean a lot. Come playoff time, that's going to mean a lot. Because you can't just launch threes all day. I'm telling you right now, that's not going to work. But the fact that Houston can take you off the dribble and go to the hole and create a foul and make their foul shots is, to me, that gives them the chance to go all the way.
I mean, you said shoot threes all day. And
Tony, I got it. Get one word. I got to get this call. Yeah, get your last word. I got to get this call. Yeah, get your last word.
No problem, man. Thanks for having me on the show. Look good to another season, and should have me on next week, bro.
You better come back on, Tony. I'm coming for you.
Let's do it, dog.
Thank you, brother. Thank you. Okay.
You got it.
Okay. Damn, I just missed it. Let me try to get him back. He's probably going crazy. Hold up, guys. He tried to call me twice. I got to call him now. Oh, I'm ramped up, man. Hello.
Hello.
Johnny Football.
Al York.
What's going on, baby? First time caller, Johnny Football. Tell the audience a little about yourself, bro.
Well, I've been a gambler pretty much all my life. I think my first bet was 1972.
God damn.
I was 6 years old. I lost, that was the year the Miami Dolphins went undefeated, and I'm just talking, you know, out of my ass, and I was like, yeah, they're going to lose this weekend in front of my dad and his brother. And he goes, I bet you $1. So I bet him $1. And I lost, and my old man made me pay up.
He made you pay it up?
Absolutely, he made me pay because you lost your bet.
Okay, Johnny, we got 13 minutes. I love the fact your father made you pay it up. That made you a man. So let's get right to it. You are LSU Tiger fan, a New Orleans Saints fan. I got a lot of Saints people that like the Saints. Educate everybody. Who that?
Well, I've been a Saints fan all my life. You know, even when we was in we're in the bad days. But we're talking about what's going to happen this year, or last year, or, you know.
This year, 2020. As a matter of fact, let me make it easier for you.
Okay.
Saints were 13-3 last year. They had the best record in the NFC. Dom, the Niners, and the Packers were all 13-3. Saints been having dismal luck in the playoffs 3 consecutive years.
Right.
Took my money. I'm pretty sure took your money. Lost Absolutely. In the worst fashion in each every game. From the Diggs bomb against Minnesota, from the pass interference, the Rams obviously was a pass interference, and last year, Kirk Cousins going deep to Thielen in overtime. And not to mention the offensive pass interference they didn't call. So, me to you, how do the Saints pan out this year? Are they the same team? Are they going to have the same record? Or you think they took a step backwards or forwards? Real quick, Johnny, because we got 11 minutes. This is going to go fast. So talk to us.
Well, I think talent-wise, we got a little better. We got rid of Wolford, the center, and we got rid of your guy, Appleby. And I was happy to see him go. So talent-wise, and we picked up a nice wide receiver. He's a little older, but he's gonna do good for us. Saunders.
Emmanuel Sanders is a beast, but go ahead.
Yes. And Fowler, his old teammate, Fowler. We grabbed him, I think, today.
I don't like Fowler. So he dropped an overtime pass for me that cost me money. But go ahead.
Yeah. So I think talent-wise, we're better. My problem is Drew's a year older, and you could really see it last year. He was, you know, the cliff is coming up, and he's starting to slide down it. You know what I'm saying? Father Time is catching up. His deep ball looked, I mean, even the year before it looked bad. It's been looking bad the last few years, but last year was really bad. I don't think he completed anything over 35 yards. So
I just think that's where he might have, but it was the 35 yards where you complete a 15 yarder and the receiver takes it.
No, he didn't throw it downfield. So I'm just a little worried that I think Drew is in decline, and I think it's going to show this year a little more. And so I'm thinking we're going to step back.
You're going to step back. So, okay, let me do this real quick. Let me say this real quick.
Okay.
You re-signed Taysom Hill, which I thought was great. I think he helps Drew Brees in numerous ways. And I didn't want to see Taysom take over the number one quarterback. No, he's not. That's not what he does.
No, Taysom, he's a part-timer. He's a part-timer.
He's got a lot of Cordell Stewart in him to slash, but he's not the slash. He's Taysom Hill. Then you got Kamara. Right. When Ingram left, Kamara kind of got exposed. He's not a one. He's not a three down back. Obviously, Kamara's more tougher coming out the backfield. Would you agree with me?
Yeah, I agree. But you know, he was injured last year, and then trying to come back, he just didn't. You know, he looked like he wasn't as explosive. So I'm gonna give him this year before I sort of close down the three down back. But yeah, I do agree that he's more. You know, you want to use him in a certain way.
For sure, for sure.
You're not going to give him as many touches as that McCaffrey.
Okay, Michael Thomas is, to me, top receiver in the league. Him and Julio Jones. Michael Thomas, I've seen this guy get open against two defenders. The guy's the beast. The acquisition of Emmanuel Sanders, like I said, is huge because he's not your main receiver. And the most underrated guy that I think is going to be so important to you guys, as long as he keep his fucking head on his head, is Jared Cook, big tight end, the guy from South Carolina. This guy is a beast.
Right.
A beast. Yes. But he's got to keep his head on. He's got to make those catches on third down to bail out Drew Brees with people on.
Right.
Now, let me go defensively real quick. Cameron Jordan, I love him on the line. I don't know too many other guys on the line. You probably know them all. But I like your secondary with Marshawn Lattimore, P.J. Williams, and Malcolm Jenkins. Talk to us real quick. We got about we got 8 minutes
up,
left.
And we picked up, we got Janarius Jenkins.
Okay.
Yes, and he's going to take Applebee's spot.
You don't like Applebee, right?
No, I did not like Applebee.
Wow. So give us a prediction on how many wins the Saints are going to have this year. And then I'm going to ask you my next question. Go ahead real quick.
I'm going to say 11. We're going to step back.
Okay, so you see 11-5, correct?
Yes.
11-5. Do they win the division?
I'm going to say no.
Okay, they don't win the division. Okay, so 11-5. Do they get through the first round of the playoffs? 11-5 might mean, Johnny, they might be on the road. If they don't win that division, and they 11-5, that means they got to be on the road. So do they get through the first round?
I don't think so. Like I said, New York, I'm just worried about Drew. I actually think that I was watching him last year, you know, him in the pocket. He can't move around the way he wants to hit. And, you know, it's just starting to show. Now, he's supposed to be working with this quarterback guru, Al, over to work on his mechanics.
Right.
For functional arm strength. But, you know, at 41, I just don't see it. You're not getting better at that age. You're getting worse.
I agree. And real quick, I noticed the defense, they've sent in the edges on them. And the first two guys up front, they kind of pretending they're rushing, but they kind of spy on them and moving with them. And then they're raising their hands up real high so it can make the target way more difficult for him since he's throwing a lot of short passes. So Drew is going to have to open up the field. If he doesn't open up the field, I might see a 9-7 year. But if I think Drew will figure it out, he's that smart, he's that good. I got your team winning at least 11 games also, and I got them clearing the first round. But then that's about it, Johnny boy.
That's what I'm looking at. Talent-wise, they're loaded. I just don't think you get better at this age. Okay. You know, I mean,
unless you're the guy I'm going to bring up right now, I'm going to bring up a guy. Tell me the first thing on your mind and tell me what he's going to do in the league this year. TB12, Tom Brady.
Championships.
Okay. What is he going to bring to the Tampa Bay Buccaneers this year? Prediction win season, division title, Super Bowl. Talk to us real quick. We got 5 minutes. We can take care of this in 5 minutes. Talk to us.
Well, the first thing he's going to do is bring a winning attitude.
Okay.
You know what I mean? And they're going to buy into it. All them young guys, they'll listen to him. You know what I'm saying? Tom Brady talks, they're going to listen.
Facts.
When he walks on the field, it's like, you know, you're with a legend. You know what I'm saying? A walking, living, breathing, fire dragon legend. You know what I'm saying? And, I mean, look, he's got all that talent with him this year. Look, why can't I could go all the way? I know everybody says, they don't have enough time to gel.
I'm kind of saying that.
Yeah.
There's a lot of people like my boy Chuck Thomas. Salute to Chuck Thomas. He loves the Tampa Bay Bucks. He gets mad when I say they're not going to win this year. They definitely a lot more talent than the 90% of the teams in the league, especially with all the new acquisitions, including Shady McCoy, who they just picked up recently. You know they got Evans, Godwill. These guys are nice.
Yes.
My thing is, I think it's going to take Brady a year to really connect with these guys. Now, like I said, they're going to beat the team they should beat. They're going to look up like they're on the same page and everything. But when the lights is on bright in the playoffs is when I think a lot of those mistakes that I'm expecting to see throughout the duration of the season, I think will happen in the playoffs. Now, I might be wrong. TB12 might go there and light it up, make it look like they never skipped a beat. That's possible. But me knowing the game long enough, I think it's going to be this year. They're going to get close. They're going to smell it. Arians is going to go recoup next year, whatever they need that they didn't have this year. And I think next year, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers would be champions. That's my opinion.
Yes. I tend to agree with that. I think it's like when Peyton Manning went over to Denver. It took them a minute. You know what I'm saying?
There you go. Because continuity is not something that happens overnight. It's like falling in love.
Right.
You can say you love the girl when you see her, but you ain't love her. You in love with her looks, but you can't possibly love her. You can't possibly pick up continuity in a fucking few weeks. And not to mention the pandemic messed up a lot of their time they could have spent together. A lot of time. So that's also working against Tom Brady. But trust me, they're going to win a lot of games. I got them to win at least 10 to 12 games. People might think I'm crazy.
I'm looking at 12.
Yeah, people might think I'm crazy.
I think 12.
But I think they still will win 10 to 12 games.
I agree.
And I just think they get bumped in the playoffs to a team that's been together. It could be your Saints. It could be the Seattle Seahawks, who are getting stronger by the day. I mean, it could be anybody. It could be the Niners. Somebody's going to get them in the NFC. And they ain't going to be no championship.
Atlanta's going to be better this year.
Yeah, Atlanta's definitely going to be better, especially with the acquisition of Todd Gurley. I think Gurley's going to have a blowout season, you know, since his leg blew out. And he hasn't been the same Gurley. He's been running tenderly. But I think his coach can say anything. But I heard the interview, and he's saying that Gurley's back to the old Gurley. He even mentioned Georgia. So when I heard that, I'm like, you know what? Matty Ice got a running game. He still got Julio and Ridley over there. So these guys, as long as they can give Matty Ice time, their defense could do anything, they're going to be also in the hunt. But, Johnny, any last words you got to say? We got 1 minute left, buddy.
Who that? Who that?
Who that all the way, baby?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I love him. Listen, I hope I'm wrong. I hope Drew balls out, but you know, I deal in reality. You know what I'm saying? I don't really get my hopes up.
All I'm saying is don't sleep on Drew Brees, but you're right. If he can't get the ball downfield, they ain't gonna win no Super Bowl. But if somehow, some way, let's say the arm was messed up and he wasn't talking about it, and he could fling it on 35, 45 deep passes, then anything's possible. Because that team's got, they gel, they better, and they got to get Kamara off. Kamara has to get off. If he gets off with Drew Brees being able to throw downfield, I see Super Bowl in the Saints' eyes. Because them three tragic losses, they could cancel that out.
Oh, yeah, we're old one.
Yeah, they could cancel all that out with a Super Bowl victory.
Everything depends on Drew's arm. He's got to have a little zip in it. He can't be throwing that ball up and they're waiting an hour for it to land.
The Eli Manning. You can't do the Eli Manning over the middle where he throws like an alley-oop and whoever catches it, catches it. Copy?
Yeah.
All right, brother. So listen, man, thank you for calling in. We're definitely going to have you back on the show. And I got something for you on the next show, but we'll talk about it on the next show. Copy?
All right. Hey,
Thank you, Johnny Football. Absolutely. My brother, man. I appreciate you, man.
Hey.
Okay, guys.
All right, brother.
Okay, guys. Two calls. We're waiting on one more. And this, you don't want to leave yet. I promise you. Hello. Welcome to the Al York Sports Show. Hello. Oh, hold up. I might have to call him back. He's probably thinking I didn't get to him. Give me a minute, guys. Yeah, y'all don't want to leave. We're going to talk a little bit of Mayweather and the next fight that was supposed to happen. I see you, Bingo.
Yeah, your sports show. It's showtime, baby.
It's showtime, baby. We got Luis Molina. I wish I could have my boy Anthony Lubriciano, Robert Carmona. These are my boxing guys. But as of right now, Luis Molina has been the only one that's got the time to put out. All these guys, to me, know they shit. Like I said, I'm not going to put nobody on my show unless you know your shit. Real fast, Molina. Let's not waste no time. Educate everybody on what's going on with the cancellation of Teofimo Lopez, a.k.a. El Brooklyn, versus Vasily Lomachenko, a.k.a. High Tech. Educate us on what's going on exactly with this supposed-to-be fight.
Well, you know, technically the fight is still not canceled. They are still trying to work details about who's going to get paid more. Of course, we all know High Tech is the fighter that's going to get paid more than any of them.
Copy.
It's just Teofimo Lopez is just trying to outprice himself. We are in the middle of a pandemic.
Copy.
His manager, David McWaters, is making a big mistake not accepting the $1.25 million that they're offering them. I just think he's probably thinking about himself and not his own fighter. It's the biggest paycheck he's ever received. He denies it. There's no one in the 130-pound division that he's going to make that kind of money, especially with no fans. It's incredible that he's denying that kind of money. It's just they're trying to squeeze ESPN maybe to fork out some cash, which I doubt they're going to do. And he should just accept it because win or lose, he's going to still make the biggest paycheck of his life. And if he wins, he's capitalizing on his name more than anybody right now. And that could be fight of the year.
My boy Lubriciano just said basically that Loma is scared to fight Lopez. Do you agree with that?
I can agree with that because he's fighting such a young guy who's been really active and is really sharp. And like I've always said, I'm a guy who likes a puncher. He's got the X factor, the gift of having that one punch knockout. He does have 15 fights with 12 by knockout.
Yeah, 15. I mean, let me rephrase. 15-0, 12 by knockout. Good point, Lewis. Go ahead.
And I'm still surprised that fighters, two of them, because Lomachenko is 15-0-10.
Yep.
I can understand why he's getting paid what he's getting paid, but a fighter like Teofimo Lopez could be made to be offered $1.325 million is out of this world. He should be getting offered $500,000.
Is that right?
Well, you know, a guy with 15 fights, who has he fought? Lomachenko has more world champions that he's fought under his belt.
Let me interject real quick. We got 15 minutes on the Al York Sports Show. I never seen a guy with so little fights have as much props as Lomachenko. I mean, I like the kid, But he's 14-1 for crying out loud. 14-1, and this guy is spoke about like he's 35-0 and shit. So educate us. What is it? Is it every fight he's fighting? It's a real tough fight, and he's succeeding. What is it about this kid that the hype is so much, and he's only 14-1? What is it about him?
You know, the credentials that he's got, he's a world gold medalist, two-time gold medalist, and he's got a good promoter. He listens to Bob Arum. Unlike Teofimo Lopez, you're promoted by somebody, but you're managed by somebody else.
Right.
And I believe Lomachenko is a company guy. He's listened to Bob Arum on his demands, and they've listened to him as well because he's got a good following. But most of the boxing world, unless you follow it like I do, casual people don't know Teofimo Lopez.
Right. You know? I'm going to be honest with you. I got lack of knowledge on him myself. I mean, I watched a few fights on YouTube. I know more about Lomachenko than I know Teofimo, but I know from my boxing guru people that L. Brooklyn is the truth. Like, he's the truth. But like I'm saying, so they both want more money. This is why it's getting canceled, or it's more Teofimo? Before I go to my next question.
It's more Teofimo. I'm sure Lomachenko is with a $3.2 million.
Louis, you're breaking up. Wherever you at, Louis, you're breaking up. Try to find a better spot. I want my peoples to hear you.
I'm saying that I'm sure Lomachenko is happy with the $3.2 million that he's being offered. It's Teofimo, man, that he's pricing himself out. We see this in boxing history, like when Luis Ortiz denied the fight against Anthony Joshua, and they offered it to Ruiz, and Ruiz goes and knocks him out and makes all this money, when Luis Ortiz had only made $500,000 in his career. So I'm sure he's regretting that, just like Teofimo's going to regret not taking that $1.325 million he's being offered.
Well, I think he's bluffing. He's going to try to get more. Then eventually, like you said, he's going to end up showing his hand. And he gonna have to get that money. Like you said, it's the biggest fight, but you can't knock him for trying to get more. But I just hope they end that and they take what's offered and they get this fight going. Next question. What does Teofimo Lopez have to do if this fight takes place? If it takes place, what does Teofimo have to do to win this fight?
Teofimo has to be Teofimo and be aggressive. No respect. Do what he's been doing as far as being aggressive and knocking people out. He's 15-0 with 12 knockouts.
Anybody on that list? Is it anybody on that list that's worth talking about that he knocked out?
Diego Magdaleno, who's a former world champion, and Comey. Those are the biggest two names that he has fought. And most people won't know who they are anyways. But he's got like a 50% knockout ratio. So he just got to be aggressive and no respect, man. A lot of people get scared when they fight Lomachenko and give him too much respect. Like Jorge Linares did, and he dropped Lomachenko, but and then eventually got knocked out himself. The thing is that Teofimo is young, he's sharp, and he's strong.
Okay. All right, so basically he's got to, like, put the pressure on Lomo. Right?
He's got to put the pressure on Lomo.
Kind of like Madonna, like Madonna tried to do to Mayweather, more like something like that?
Exactly. The total like that.
Okay. Now I'm going to ask the same question on the other side. What does Lomachenko, a.k.a. High Tech, has to do to win this fight?
Lomachenko has to use his experience, his ring gentlemanship, as far as the angles, side to side, He is a great boxer because he comes from that Olympic style of boxing, and that it's carried him throughout his career, except for the second fight against Toledo. It was a rugged fight, and Toledo ended up beating him for his challenge of a world title, and only his second pro fight. If Teofimo could do that, I don't see Lomachenko being able to win. Lomachenko's got to just box, angles, side to side, and a lot of bending, man.
Okay. Lomo got that one hit of quitter, though. Don't sleep, man. That guy can lay you down with that one luck, might one shot also, but I got you. One's got to fight more aggressive. One's got to be more boxer. Okay, real quick, give everybody your prediction.
100%.
Give everybody your prediction.
You know, man, like I said before on your last show, I'm all about that one-punch knockout, and I believe Teofimo has it more. I'm not trying to be biased, but he's got that Latino blood, and that's what I'm going to go, man, Teofimo Lopez.
Teofimo Lopez, your winner. If you had a prediction, knockout, distance, what would it be?
Teofimo Lopez.
Distance or knockout?
Yeah, Teofimo Lopez. 100%.
No, but what would it be? Would it go the distance, 12 rounds, or would it be by knockout?
Well, you know, nowadays, yeah, I see a 12-round decision.
Okay.
12-round decision.
It don't matter. Listen, if he wins by knockout, you're going to get the same credit. Because I can't.
Yeah.
Put that much pressure on you. You just got to pick who you think is going to win. You taking Teofimo. And from my understanding, he should be the underdog in this type of caliber of a fight, correct?
Yes, of course. He's fighting that Lomachenko would be the most decorated fighter he will face.
Okay, let's go to our next topic. Great topic on this. I appreciate your answers. They were good. They were detailish. And I know my peoples loved it because that's how we do on the Al York Sports Show. We got 7 minutes for this last topic. When I mention the name Floyd Mayweather, what pops up in your head? And give me some time. I need some time myself. Yeah.
When you mention that name, I say and think greatest fighter of all time, especially of my generation. A guy who faced 16 world champions, a guy who came from featherweight to junior middleweight and has fought everybody and beat everybody. No doubt. Floyd Mayweather Jr.
Okay. I have to admit, I took my personal feelings about him and I threw it in the ring when I should have never have done. You know, I don't like the way the guy roams. I don't like how he roams. I don't like how he screamed on his pops. I felt he was real disrespectful. But that got nothing to do with boxing. So let me separate the two. When I was, you know, a couple years back, I was using that against him. I have to admit that I never seen defense like Floyd Mayweather. The guy's defense is second to none. You know what I'm saying? The guy is the guy's the most prepared fighter I ever seen. Nobody, I think, works out as hard. And not to mention, Floyd wins fights before he even fights. And I think I spoke this to you the last time I seen you. He's got at least 5 brainiacs that know fighting, from Ellaby to the Mayweathers, rest in peace, Roger, his father, and all the other brain surgeons that know the game of boxing, including himself. So when they're prepared for a fight, they know exactly what route to take, what he needs to do, how he has to work out, and Floyd accomplishes all of that. So I got to give him credit for that. I have to. So I have to say, yes, he's a great fighter, maybe the greatest in this generation, but to me, not all time. I got Muhammad Ali all the time. I got Muhammad Ali, and my favorite fighter who, this is just throwing it in the air, is Sugar Ray Leonard. And I think Sugar Ray had how to beat Floyd Mayweather, from speed to knowledge to can take a blow and can give a blow. But that's only hypothetically, just basically, I'm just assuming, because it will never happen. There's no way that fight could take place. So we're just, you know, we're just imagining. That's all we're doing.
But we got that's a dream. We got opinion. A dream.
Yeah, that's just my opinion. But I got to admit, right now, this generation, Floyd ran through them all. Now, I can always say he always fought guys at the tail end of their career, but he still got to win the fight. Like, I was knocking Floyd for a lot of stuff because, like I said, I really didn't like him. I'm going to stop being like that because it's unfair to anybody to do him like that, because it's like Pete Rose. He gambled, but what he did on the field to me was different. Unfortunately, his gambling caused him what he did on the field, but to me, it didn't take nothing away of how he played the game. So I'm going to say the same with Mayweather. Regardless how he acts out of the ring, how like stuck up or how he be dissing people in the ring, I got to admit, the guy's the best in this generation. Anything you want to add on?
Just to add on that, I mean, there's a reason he's been called himself TBE, the best ever. Because at the end of the day, he was the best ever to ever promote his own self and make the kind of money that he was able to make. And he always backed up everything he said. And like I said once before already, he fought more world champions than anybody in boxing history. And that alone should put you at the top five of the greatest boxers of all time.
I agree. And my boy Hump says Sugar Ray Robinson. Humpty, you definitely can't go wrong with that. The reason why I can't go that back, because I didn't watch Sugar Ray Robinson. I know I could catch clips of him. I understand that. But I always say it's nothing like when you watch it yourself. It's like Michael Jordan.
Exactly.
These young guys didn't watch Michael. You could go to clips, but it's not the same as watching it live.
It's not the same.
You know that and I know that. So that's why I can't go Robinson. Ali, I maybe watched a couple fights, but even to be honest with you, I really couldn't watch Ali like that. But I really watch all his fights. I mean, I broke down his fights, the way he moves and all that. I love the way he went into a fight and how he handled every fight. And I just loved him. That's why, to me, he's the best. But people can definitely second guess that. I'm not saying he's the best. It means he's the best. That's my opinion. But Floyd Mayweather, like I said, I got to admit it. This generation, as much as it hurts me to say this because I don't really like him, but I got to keep it real on my show. If I don't keep it real on my show, then I'm not keeping it real with y'all. And that's on God. That's on God right there. So, Lewis, any last words you want to say? We almost done because of time restraints. Great conversation. Any last things you want to say, brother?
You know, I just want to thank you for having me on your show, man. And stay tuned for what's coming. Boxing's still getting hot. There's events coming up and a lot more than we could talk about in the future. And stay tuned. Al York Sports all
Listen,
day. Showtime, baby.
Stay sharp because I'm coming to you, baby. I'm coming to
Let's
you.
Let's do it.
My other dudes are busy. As long as they're busy, I'm going to keep coming to you. Once they get time, I'm going to get them on. But listen, God bless you. Enjoy your weekend. Thank you for coming on. And we're going to talk soon, Mr. Lewis Molina.
All right.
Okay,
have a good
brother.
One. York Sports.
You already know,
have
baby.
Have a good one.
All right. God bless, baby. Guys.
God bless.
1 hour. That's all
one
it took.
Late.
4 callers. 1 hour. Breaking it down every which way. Every which way. I know how to do it with y'all. With their services also. Because it takes teamwork to get this here done. And like I said, y'all, I'm going to provide the platform that none of us got an opportunity to rock on. Al York Sports is bringing it to everybody. Real talk. Because I didn't get opportunity. Motherfuckers didn't want me on their show. Motherfuckers don't want to put me on. But I'm going to get myself on. I promise you. Some way or another. And once I do, Everybody I fuck with will be on my show. And that's how I rock. Excuse my cursing. I apologize. But I just get amped up like that. Y'all take care. God bless. Another session of open sessions. Catch y'all Tuesday. Hold your head. God bless y'all, man. And no drinking and driving. Al York Sports.